There we go. Welcome, everyone. This is Cheryl Millett, and we're going to talk about omegas from all that I know and can bring to the table here, having worked 10 years in the seal oil. But as a result of working in the seal oil, I've gained a lot of knowledge about the different types of omegas, and then I bring forth also the information from my corporate days, which is working in commodities and purchasing. So that would include the vegetable oil for the bakeries. And we also had fisheries as well. And quite often the sardines are packed in various oils. So oils, veg oil was something that our department was involved in purchasing. So that's a little bit of background. Aside from, I did study holistic nutrition about 15, 20 years ago. And that gave me enough knowledge to know that we are deficient and that supplementation can be very helpful depending on the foods that we're eating. In most cases, there's a lot of highly processed foods out there. And depending on how they are grown will depend on what is in the food itself. And processing would get rid of a lot of the nutrients, be it vitamins. So let's carry on. One of the articles I just wrote yesterday was raw seal oil is not special. And the idea is that raw seal oil, or even seal blubber that the Inuit used to consume, Inuit equaling people, so Inuit means people in their language, so they consumed raw seal blubber. It's just a part of their lifestyle, a part of their healthy choices to have them healthy. And so I wanted to make this clear because there's definitely a number of testimonials. The seal oil has always been around. The seal oil has been there. I mean, if we had done research on it hundreds of years ago, we would have had the same results. It's always been around. So there's nothing created here in the last little while other than people are aware of it. And it is now in a supplement bottle. And that's really all that is. And that's why I wrote that article, because there is amazing results, yes. But the results would have happened with raw seal oil earlier on. If we get down into the fundamentals, most people are familiar with what I will call the three major types of omegas that are sold as supplements. And some of this is food, and we've been adding it to our food, like flax oil, perhaps. So we have plant, we have fish, and we also have mammal. So I didn't say herring. I didn't say the type of plant. But let's say those three categories. Krill is not a triglyceride. It is actually for food for the sperm whales. I'm going to leave krill out. However, it is a common question. What is the difference with krill? And that would make a difference on the absorption, which would make, again, a difference on the effectiveness of the krill oil. And let's see the three differences here, or talk to the three differences here. The three key differences between plant and the fish and the mammal is the length of chain of the essential fatty acid, but also how they're brought together. The plant in itself is shorter, and we do require a certain amount of it to be converted into long chain. So we do require the long chain. But the plant forms are what they call the essential, typically. And most people with any conditions has a dysfunctioning digestive system for how that all comes together and would not be doing the conversion effectively. That's what a number of the research for over the years as to why people should be start taking fish oil is when they measured the levels of, let's say, EPA or DHA, the longer chain form, then they were deficient. And that's that. So if we look at the fish eats the plant, or let's say the algae of plants, and they actually have a longer chain. But the mammals eat the fish. In this case, let's talk to the harp seal, because that's really the only supplement that's out there is the seal oil. And that is actually a longer chain yet than the fish oil. Now that actually brings to light that both fish and mammal, and what you would see in breast milk being a mammalian source, actually is on a triglyceride, which if we're looking at it, there's three fatty acids and there's a glycerol molecule that it's attached to. Fish and mammals would have this triglyceride position. The krill doesn't, and the plant does not. What that means in the difference between the fish that is longer chain and the mammal, which is long chain and a bit longer, is that the positioning of the essential fatty acids is different for the mammal. It is actually, if we want to look at it, is 1, 2, and 3, 2 being kind of like a middle position. The fish essential fatty acid is on the middle one, whereas the other mammal, let's say seal, is actually on the SN1 position and the SN3 position. Why is that important? The key reason that is important is because our body will absorb the lipase enzymes that are in the mouth that break down the fats, would actually absorb the SN3 position. It would break off, would not absorb it, it would break off, that's what the lipase would do. It's an enzyme, and we have sublingual glands, it's part of the salivary glands, that would actually absorb the mammalian essential fatty acid that is in that third position. That means within minutes it goes directly into the bloodstream and get pumped through the body. Whereas if we swallow the oil, then what has to happen, it has to go into the digestive system, and depending on how congested or mucousy or dysfunctioning the digestive system is, will depend upon how much is absorbed within the digestive system. And it would take longer, of course, but the mammalian is preferred again in the digestive system. The lipase enzymes would prefer the first position of a mammalian triglyceride molecule. And that is an important thing. When we think of the sublingual absorption, people who have dysfunctioning digestive systems, which is in every case in all conditions, even according to Western or even my holistic nutrition background, Ayurvedic, which is Indian medicine in India, the way they treat there, and also Chinese medicine, there's always a dysfunctioning digestive system. So when we look at stress too as a factor for digestive, if people are under stress, then they're not digesting as well. But if they hold it on their tongue for a minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, we then have the effective absorption of the mammalian essential fatty acids, in this case, aka omega-6 and omega-3. The next key difference is the actual forms of omega, like a recipe for any for anything. Let's think of salad dressing. There's many different recipes. In this case, the recipe, or let's say the various omega-3s that are in fish, to simplify it, is actually DHA and EPA, docosahexaenoic acid and eicosapentaenoic acid. When it comes to the seal oil, there's actually a third one, DPA. DPA, docosahexaenoic acid, is also in the seal, and that's also within our body naturally. If we think of the breast milk, it's primarily made of DHA and DPA. So that's that. When we come to plant, of course, they have LA and ALA. They do not have any of the EPA and the DPA there. And if they talk to plants having DHA, it is still a different structure or a different molecule. Not all DHAs are the same. The third difference, key factor in the different omegas for being effective, is the balance of ratio of omega-6 to omega-3. So omega-3 is one of the essential fatty acids, and the first double bond, if you remember your chemistry and carbon chains, is at the third position. That's why, and it's at the omega, so at the end, that's why it's called omega-3. For omega-6, it's the sixth bond, or the first bond is at the sixth carbon. That's why they call it omega-6. So these are two essential. And balancing, having them balanced in our body is a good thing. Omega-6 would actually cause inflammation, which in a case of healing or fever or needing to fight a fever or needing to fight infection, and in maybe injury, omega-6 comes to the rescue and it is very helpful. So it's essential fatty acid. We need not be afraid of it. Unfortunately, what's happening out there is we have a lot of refined omega-6, the very cheap omega-6, plant, especially when we think of canola, corn, the sunflower, all those oils, seed oils specifically. But even fish has a different ratio. So let's go back to what omega-3. Omega-3 is touted as bringing down inflammation, and therefore omega-6 and omega-3 actually need each other. Omega-6 comes into action to fight against things and to support the body, thinking of the immune system. And the omega-3 comes in and lowers the inflammation. And that's very vital. They have other functions as well as just around inflammation. Now, in a mammal or in breast milk or in the seal, it actually is a one-to-one ratio, naturally one-to-one. Those people who are consuming a lot of plant and so forth, the plant have a variety of ratios. So we're looking for a one-to-one of natural omega-6 to natural omega-3. We would still want healthy forms of omega-6 in our diet. And therefore, a lot of people are now, and I surely let them know, to remove the unhealthy refined oils. Now let's go into a couple of examples of the ratios in for plants. So corn oil, which is still used a lot in restaurants perhaps, it's still there. And that is on average, or let's say I've read a couple of numbers, but I'm going to take the lower one, 50 omega-6 to 1 omega-3. So aside from it being way off naturally, high in omega-6 to 3, and also it would be refined oil, which is completely different than having something in its raw. But if it would be raw, it'd still be unbalanced. And I keep telling people that the key reason why it's imbalanced is seeds, when they need to become plants, actually need that inflammatory response. That's an inflammatory response for the seed to pop open and to become a plant. And that's why the plants will typically be a more balanced ratio of the essential fatty acids, but they'll be used up. So plants aren't necessarily very, very high in fats, but they do have some, of course. And that's the reason why plants, and of course many of these things are actually seed oils, and the polyunsaturated fats is really what we're looking at here, not the monounsaturated fats, which is the olive oils, and not the saturated fats, which are the butter and the coconut oil. But the polyunsaturated fatty acids are the essential fatty acids, which we need and can use for the various functions like managing inflammation and for brain health. So those are the three significant differences when it comes to that. And I should mention about what the ratio is of fish. On average, omega-6 to omega-3 for fish, especially cold water, and cold water is really where it has its fat anyway, rather than the tropical, is on average 10 omega-6 to 1 omega-3. So that is higher in omega-6. Why? Because in the cold water, it needs to increase its metabolism. It needs to have a burst of energy. And that would mean omega-6, right? It's kind of like an inflammatory response. The fish, in order to get into action, would actually require the omega-6 to do that. So the ratios that we have in nature, in our animals, such as the seal, in ourselves as a mammal as well, in the fish and the plants, are there because that is natural. We wouldn't want to change that. And we can surely eat some of these products, absolutely, combine them with. But I mean, this is the next key thing that is a difference. Now that we've talked about the three key differences between plant, a fish, and mammal, at let's say a raw level, if they were all made raw. But here's one of the things that's very, very important in my mind, and having come from food processing and oil refining, is that if you look at the oil refining, it is a standard process, but it makes oils safe, which is not a bad thing. I mean, you put a jug of oil in your cupboard, it's on the shelf for a long time, maybe it's sitting in the warehouse for a long time. They can be stored for a long time, these oils, without going rancid. whether they're in their jug or whether they are used in the making of cookies and breads and so forth. So they're safe. That's what I call them. The refined foods, the highly processed foods, and the ones that are using these highly refined ingredients are safe foods, which is they don't go moldy, but they are unhealthy foods. And they would absolutely be not likened to the trans fats that we are now banned in Canada. They are somewhere in the unhealthy fats, but maybe not to that degree. Who knows? Who knows? Unhealthy, you don't want to put it in your body anyway. So the idea is to start to consume fats that are raw or cold pressed, similar as we've been very used to with the olive oil. And unless it says cold pressed on the label, it is definitely refined. And if it usually won't say refined on the oil, it'll just have the oil, but it should say cold pressed on there. So that's your nacho chips, your crackers, not Mary's crackers. But there's all of these foods. And if you just start looking at what's in them, you'll start to see sunflower, safflower, better than the corn oil and the soybean and the canola oil and some of these organics, but still refined oils nonetheless. So the other thing that brings to light with the differences is plant oils are very susceptible, especially something like flaxseed oil, very susceptible to oxidation. And we have fish we know is very susceptible to oxidation, but the mammal is naturally stable. The mammal, actually, the oil is very stable. It's naturally stable. I'm not going to say it's like butter. It's not butter. It's not a saturated fat. But it seems to be stable for its molecular structure that it has. When we look at seal and seal blubber, it is actually firm very much like the butter. And, to get it put into a bottle means that you just have to gently filter it and put it in, and that remains raw. The other thing that I want to bring up, because I think it's very important, and it's also a question I get asked very often, is about the toxicity in oils. So this is a big topic in itself, so I can spend a few minutes here on the toxicity of oils. Now, fat-soluble toxins are many. And it's very easy to see why our body would store toxins in our fat cells, because they are fat-soluble toxins. That's where they get stored best. We have fat cells, and that's where we can store the toxins. Now, when it comes to toxicity, the toxicity that we could see in plant, obviously, is the pesticides or chemicals that they would be using. Even in the refining process, they're using bleach, and they're degumming, and they're using these chemicals to do that. And the fat would actually pick up some of that, right? So molecules there. But if we think of natural fats in the sense of fish, fish oil, the fish are not even evolved as the seal, or even as us, to detoxify the best we can. And the fish will pick up, depending on where they are, will concentrate the, inorganic mercury, depending on what is there. And that's tested. And we do have to test our foods for the reasons we do, for toxicity and so forth, so we can be assured that there is that happening. And some of that's being taken out when you refine oils, for sure. That's one of the things that is very helpful when you refine. So we can see the benefit there. The benefit is that we have these safe oils. Yes, the toxicity can be removed to the degree it can, because they can filter and so forth. But then you don't have, it's like having something that is dead, something that is not nutritious anymore. It's just there. It looks like an oil, but it's not alive anymore. It's not living. And we have the vibration is different for those who work with vibration. And when we have fish oils and they do that, yes, they have to take that out. But when the seals consume the fish, they are wild. So they're not farmed. That's the other aspect of fish as well. They're in the habitat of a lot of fish, and they have to deal with the toxicity of waste as well. When the seals are in their wild and they consume what they consume, and they only eat as much as they eat and they have the space they have, they are naturally toxic free. And naturally toxin free is very huge today because we have enough toxins everywhere else. Now, some people will say that the seal will actually eat the fish and it should concentrate in the seal. But I haven't found any evidence that. I looked back in the early research, and it was in northern Quebec. And when it came to the fish and it came to the analyzing food and the toxins, the Inuit people there were actually consuming both fish and seal. So they weren't sure. In the actual research that I read, having to search it down, they weren't sure where the toxins were coming from. But I can tell you from lab reports, there's basically traces of certain things, perhaps one being arsenic. And you might say arsenic, but we have organic arsenic, and organic arsenic is nowhere near the same thing as inorganic arsenic. So we have to be careful to define the actual toxins and the elements that are on our planet between inorganic and organic. No different than supplements. When we're looking at supplements, we have organic calcium and we have inorganic calcium. And they're two different things, and they'd be absorbed in the body differently that way. So the seal is naturally toxic free. The seal is naturally stable. The harp seal, or let's say just the seal and mammal, is actually have a formula or the right forms that are similar to us. And they also have a triglyceride that's similar to it's again mammalian triglyceride, which means that we have sublingual absorption, and that's very important as well. And then naturally, so that we can look at it in a healthy picture, is that it's naturally 1:1 omega-6 to omega-3. The last thing I wanted to talk about, just being mindful of the time, is actually the research. And the research has been going on for years now, and introducing some people at UFT to the OM, they really wanted to try it out with athletes. So that's one of the formal published research that happened several years ago. And that resulted in Olympic athletes, although they have to say elite in the research, actually improving their strength and their recovery time. And recovery time absolutely would be tied to the nervous system, the immune system. And having run marathons, I can tell you that running the long runs, 2 to 3 hours, actually suppresses the immune system. This is actually in literature, so anyone can read this. And when you do that much exercise and you suppress the immune system, you're susceptible to getting colds. You're susceptible to feeling run down. And that was clear every time I did my long run, or we got to the training for long runs, that was clear. I was wiped out for the rest of the afternoon. When that research came through, the same people that were working with the OM at the University of Toronto decided they would work with the OM to finish off their PhD for one of them and submit something to the Diabetes Association to actually do a research on diabetes. And this is the scenario for there. The omegas are very helpful for nerve, especially the long chains for nerves. And in the way of the athletes, well, that would be strength, because you cannot move a muscle without having the nerve coming in and sending the signal. It's probably the easiest way to say it there. So when it came to diabetes and nerves, they wanted to study diabetic neuropathy, and in this case, neuropathy of the eye. And so they were measuring the corneal nerve fiber length. So as that shortens, and they're monitoring this within diabetic patients, that they're actually growing shorter and shorter. And there's a certain point in time where it gets into highly degenerated, and that would be high risk for blindness. And that's just what's next. So in the medical field, actually what ends up happening is they only have pain meds for that, because this is like aging, right? Shrinking. It's very painful. When it's in the feet, very painful. They get ulcers, they tingling, almost like when you lose your oxygen because circulation isn't working at the same time. So that resulted in, over the 1 year with type 1 diabetics, just to kind of narrow down the group, 29% on average nerve growth. Now, for those who were actually in the range, because there were three or four groups or categories of groups at where they were in their levels here, the ones that were at high risk actually had, I understood that there was a 60% nerve growth within a year, only taking one teaspoon. And for practitioners and doctors, one teaspoon is the recommended. But now, outside of that, and have been for years, therapeutic dosing can be used, which I highly recommend. With cancer neuropathy, that's a current research, and that research is ongoing, and it's a much bigger study than the diabetic neuropathy, but it's really about cancer treatment neuropathy. When the doctor got in touch with me several years ago, actually, that was to share that neuropathy happens 100% of the time when there's cancer treatment, and so they were using this. So if you know anybody with cancer or cancer treatment, this would be highly, the OM raw sea oil would be very instrumental in helping the chemo do its job, from what I understand, and also from avoiding neuropathy or lessening it, or maybe not at all. Who knows? I haven't got the research on that. The other research, which is going to come, I'm having a meeting here on November the 19th. I'm going to get a firsthand update on a current research that's being done with children who are on the spectrum. And I've only since seen some videos of the parents. In that case, their children were more social. They're actually now looking directly at them, and the behaviors, the learning, all these things. So I'm going to get an update myself on the 19th for that. He'll have just participated in some meetings. But earlier on, when the published research is the published research that I just spoke about, but there's been field research that's been happening with MS. I did field research with some triathletes and a group of people, and some there's one done on knee pain, and another one, two of them, which were done with children, once again, ADHD and autism. And they were very promising. If you go onto my website, CherylMillett.com, and you go under research, and it'll have another one where it says Cheryl's research to choose from under OM Omegas, you'll see the results. There are the summary of the results there. So that's really what I wanted to speak to today. Obviously on CherylMillett.com, under the products, I actually did create a summary of the differences, not in any great length, but there is definitely the material there, and pictures of the different triglyceride molecules and so forth. That's really what I wanted to wrap up today. I'm always open to answering questions. On CherylMillett.com, you can easily contact me if you don't already have my email address, which is info@CherylMillett.com, and that's CherylMillett. And all of the information is on there for the most part, but you may have certain questions regarding the seal hunt, regarding anything else. And if you can't find it on there by searching it, because it is on there to a certain degree, then feel free to give me a call. I'm going to just end with that and stop the recording here. And that is about 30 minutes. And this is going to be uploaded on YouTube. You can just search Cheryl Millett, and you'll actually get the YouTube channel where there will be other recordings as well. And that will be very helpful to go through the different, I'm going to go through different aspects of seal oil in more length.